Amen.
My hands and my
this with joy and were amazed. He asked them, "Do you have anything to eat?" And they gave him a piece of baked fish. He took it and he ate it in front of them. He then said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he then said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance, the forgiveness of sins, would be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things." This is the truth. Peace be with you. Church between 6 p.m. and 10 p.m. And what we began to talk about was religion. And in the modern world, she was the perfect characteristic. She was charming, she was well-educated, she was very beautiful. And yet on the supernatural realm, she was very confused. Like the vast amount of people in the world today. So she didn't know if she was Catholic. She didn't understand the distinction and say, well, you know, a Christian Catholic is like this, doesn't matter. And she said to me, I don't know, my parents would take me to church sometimes. And then she said to me that the church's name was St. Ambrose, because they're Catholic. You're going to St. Ambrose, you're Catholic, or you're Episcopalian. She said, no, I'm not Episcopalian. Okay? So, my process of elimination, you must be Catholic. And that's barely all that she knew. And so for about a 15-minute period, we talked about grace. What is this notion of this gift, this touch of the divine in our lives? And for 15 minutes, we discussed the idea that what grace does, it comes to us, and it allows us to become greater than what we would be in our normal presuppositions, our preconceptions, our prejudices, and everything that limits us into the little human lives that we live, to make us go beyond those limits to be greater and more good than what we actually could have considered that we could have been prior. This is not 15 minutes. She's watching through the window, she's just sitting in the truck, just standing out there showing up and not free. And she's very intent. She finished it. When I finished this 15 minutes, she says,
prior to those before them. And so it is each generation.
follow. And the link in this chain is the Lord in heaven. Now picture to yourself the vision of the European world of the Roman Empire. We have now, of course, the Brexit, England, with the United Kingdom exiting the European Union. But the idea of the European Union under the Romans was huge. Constantine is born in what is now modern-day Serbia. His mother is Greek and is born in what is now modern-day Anatolia, which is now modern-day Turkey. His father is going to be emperor of the West, ruling out of England and out of what's now modern-day France. And when Constantine himself is declared emperor by the troops in the early 300s, it is in the city which is now known as York, in the country now known as England. That is the vast expanse of the world. And from this Greek woman born in obscurity, what's now Turkey, to her son being declared as being emperor, she was going to first liberate and allow Christianity to be practiced, and then set in motion a whole series of events that within a century, less than 100 years, is going to become the official religion of the Roman Empire. Where is the link? One woman. And on this first communion day, especially to our blessed mother is here today, in the image of the blessed mother. Understand what we hold in this generation of women. Where are your great-grandchildren going to be? Will they have a bare bones idea that maybe somewhere in the past we were Syrian and Antioch Maronite Catholics? Or is it going to be that somewhere at the beginning of the 20th century I got great-great-grandparents who came from the Ottoman Empire and I'm occasionally Kibbe? As much as it is wonderful and lovely, is not what our Lord came to bring to the world. This, the altar, the Eucharist, the sacrifice, first communion to receive our Lord, body, blood, soul, and divinity, that is what he came to bring to the world. Helen is this one link. We focus on her. Because she's born in obscurity about the year 250. So when she's a little girl running around in whatever village it is in the Bithynia that she's born in, the persecutions of Dacius are raging throughout the 250s. So when she's probably about 8, 7, 8, they are slaughtering people around, especially the Eastern Empire. It initiates many of the great hermit movements into the desert. Famous St. Paul is from that origin. Because as an 18-year-old young man, he nearly wanted to escape from being killed for being Christian. He went out into the desert. And somehow this young man discovered something in the desert that he didn't have prior to his 18th birthday. And he wound up staying in the desert and is now known to us as being the first hermit, at least that we know of. He died at the age of 110. So he spent most of his life prayer and contemplation. What did he find that we do not know? What did he find that we keep him there for almost a century? Having first just tried to save his life and not be killed, save his skin, what did he discover as a 20-something in that desert? That is the persecution that Helen, as a little girl running around, is living through. Probably aware of, because people are being arrested. At least within an hour and the notable region where she grew up. She meets Constantius Varus, a young soldier, and the two of them fall madly in love on their first meeting. Constantius also did a romance with Constantine's father, because he recognized that this young woman working in this inn, and he both had wings that were made out of silver. We do this when we're in love, right? We find silly little details and we say, it's a sign from the gods that this is meant. Constantius fell hell over heels for this woman. They married, and her first child was Constantine. She had him at about the age of 22. But because of the way circumstances happened, this young, what we say now, kind of Serbian young soldier, began to move up in the ranks. And as he moved up through the ranks, this obscure Greek woman was meeting called it, do you remember Constantius the Pig? And so at one point he separates from her and he marries a senator's daughter. But he still is badly in love with her. And so he always has her set up, taken care of, after all, with his son, while he does his political thing, eventually reaching the pinnacle and becoming emperor of the West. But because of Helen, remember the wings. This is a good woman. You can have all the propaganda you want about Christianity being antisocial, being atheistic. And that was the propaganda. But I know this woman. Ain't everybody else antisocial, atheistic, and horrendous for the empire? But she's wonderful. And that is how people don't hear propaganda, because they know someone who is truly a profoundly following gospel. Helen is that thing, which is why when Diocletian performed the greatest persecution, in which tens of thousands died, they died in the east, because Constantius Florus in the west would not impose and enforce the laws coming from out of Rome. Why? Because of him. Because the woman who lived the gospel that he knew showed goodness. And so he would not persecute the Christians in what is now Spain, and France, and England. We read about the martyrs. They're not from those countries. The law was not imposed. They're out of Egypt. They're out of the Middle East. They're out of Greece. And so, of course, when his son becomes emperor, the age of 32 or so, there's a man, my mother. My mother gave me a respect. He's still paid, but gave me an understanding of Christianity, which then sets Constantine the Great on motion towards liberating the gospel so that it can be believed. But I want to spend a little time today just to understand, because the parents were here, and the grandparents, who knows, perhaps great grandparents. You are these. You hold in your hand the entire store of reality. You can pass in its integrity, the Catholic faith, in its Syriac Maronite form, this tradition, and die in peace knowing that you have not broken the chain. Or you can become completely preoccupied by the things of this world, paying our mortgage and making sure that we get everything done because we live in an accelerated rapid. So we can allow that to pull us down into a vortex. And maybe we think to ourselves it's not our fault, but the effect will be the same. The chain will be broken. The tradition will be lost. What you have received from your great-great-grandparents coming out of the Middle East, or whatever country they came out of, will have been broken. So on this day of our first Holy Communion, we talk to the children during the festival. The parents also give you their best congratulations. You have held on to the link to this moment. Surely with all the hundreds of Maronites who live in this area, there should be more children sitting here. There are many things that have been broken. There have been many traditions lost, and there have been many who have refused to be witnesses to the gospel that we hear in today's reading. So the question becomes, do we embrace grace and beauty and truth, the possibility of a greater extension of our lives, as Helen did, surrounded by pagans, or do we simply acquiesce, succumb, collapse, and break away in it, touching it occasionally perhaps during our lives, but in the end the tradition is lost. Hopefully our choice is for grace, beauty, truth, and perseverance in the tradition of Catholic faith. And in doing so, may Saints Constantine and Helen, who are identified as equal to the apostles, may their prayers be with us always in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you.
He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the power of the Son, who with the Father and the Son is Lord and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We confess our baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look forward to the resurrection.
1994, for the Annapolis St. James, Brother of the Lord.
Glory be to the Lord, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
His glow is flowing like a river.
Thank you.
John the Forerunner, St. Stephen, the Archdeacon and First Martyr, St. James, Brother of the Lord, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Mary, St. Constantine, St. Paul, and all the saints. In your grace, count us among them in the Church of the Firstborn, who are enrolled in heaven. We praise you, O Lord.
Offerings and the gifts presented to you and have perfected them by the grace of your Holy Son. God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy.
Holy gifts of the Holy Spirit, perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for a new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
The hosts of the angels have come to stand with us at the holy altar. They sing in chorus and carry Christ the Lamb, sacrifice before us. Oh, come, we receive him, the saving Lamb of God, who will grant forgiveness. Alleluia.
So
Jesus is my Lord. I will find my faith in Him. For I know His God lives within me every day. Jesus is my Lord.
Thank you. Sins, that I may